Peter's prayer, when he was sinking, may not have been very long, and it may not have been really theological, but all he did was cry out, right? Lord, help me. That's all he could say. And the Lord reached down and pulled him out. See, the darkness can go for long periods of time. It can be short, it can be long, whatever. The first step, as you journey through the dark night, respect the necessity of silence. Satan can begin to whisper into your ears that God is being cruel, that God has abandoned you, that maybe you've pushed God away. So many of those that come to us feel that maybe they've committed the unpardonable sin and now they're destined for hell. As the enemy whispers this, there's no hope for you. Let me tell you, beloved, we have a God of hope. And there's not anything that you're going through that you're hopeless. It's impossible to be hopeless with a God of hope. And he said in the Word, he's given us everything for life and godliness. But realize that during this time, you may be crying out, but there's going to be a silence. The second thing, remember, you're not alone. So many Christians have experienced in their lives what you're experiencing. You're going through maybe a spiritual dry, I don't know what you want to call it, a dry period. You feel you're in the desert or whatever that's going through, but you're not alone. There's others going through. You go through this alone, possibly, but others are going through this very same thing. The third thing, remember, and this is vital, remember God is not judging you for having less feelings. Spiritual feelings are not the gauge of our spiritual maturity. God will not judge you because you have less feelings at this time. See, feelings are not a reward of God, and the lack of feelings are not the punishment of God. We've shared this with you. In Revelation chapter 12, it says that Satan is the deceiver. What is the difference between Satan the liar and Satan the deceiver? Remember, a lie is just a plain lie. It's just an absolute, outright lie. A deception is when your mind and emotions believe something that's not true. So it's a lie with feelings. But the problem is that in our culture, we've been trained to believe what we feel and not to believe what we don't feel. This morning, as I sort of drug myself out of bed and went in to take a shower to get over here early, I don't know if I felt like a Christian. Maybe I wasn't one. You know, when I have the flu, I don't feel very spiritual. In fact, I feel more like dying. You ever had the flu and said, Lord, if you want to take me, it's fine. This is terrible. But we base so much on our feelings. And so as these feelings begin to go, we're in trouble. I love this. One of the old classic writers said this. I want to read it to you. When God takes the feelings away, We need to remember that spiritual feelings are the beginning, not the end of Christian living. Now, this was written hundreds of years ago. Fenelon said that, and he also said, how many souls, having had too tender a childhood in Jesus Christ, too delicate, too dependent on so much mild milk, draw back and give up the life that's within when God begins to wean them. They make the sanctuary out of what was the porch of the temple. Don't you want to go deeper? Do you want to stay on the porch? Or do you want to enter into the holies of holies, to the very presence of God, where He can minister to you? Often, the way into the holies of holies, way into that deep relationship with God, is going through the dark night of the soul. Number four. Remember, oh, we said that one, didn't we? Remember that feelings have a limited role in Christian living. The fifth one, take up your cross. We never so need to abandon ourselves to God as when He seems to abandon us. Seems to abandon us as we're going through this dark time. God is plunging us into the night of pure faith. And we need to be willing to suffer the agony of the darkness of the soul. When we go through that, often God begins to sift. Remember He said to Peter? God said, Peter, Satan has asked permission to sift you like wheat. Well, I've been to other countries around the world. I remember in various countries in Africa watching the women with the big round type of a woven thing, a disc type of woven thing, taking the wheat and throwing it in the air so the wind could blow the chaff out of it. That's really what the Bible is talking about. But let's bring it down to today. In the old days, people bought wheat flour in big sacks. And if you live in the South, women sifted the flour for a number of reasons. The first reason is because it wasn't pre-sifted. The second reason was to keep the critters out of the cake and the lumps. And God can use the dark night to sift us so that the critters and the lumps in our life stay in the sieve, and the shaker thing, and He can dump it out. Often, we sense that we're walking with God and we're high with God because of all of the things He has done for us. And often, this is a time where God begins to show us that our motives were not right. You know, are we like those that stop following Jesus because He stopped the miracle of bread and fish? You know, are we going deeper with Him? Is it just because of what He's given to us, or is it because of who He is? And as we take up the cross, we want to realize that God is taking us through a time of dying to self. Jesus said, if any man will come after me, let him deny what? Self, and take up his cross daily and follow me. The sixth one, and this is so important. We've seen so many people do this. Don't seek spiritual feelings in new circumstances. as we begin to feel these feelings are going, then people often go out and seek new spiritual feelings and spiritual experiences that will give them feelings. Dr. Don Harper is here. I said one of our counselors. He's in the audience someplace, and you can recognize him because he has a doctor's coat on and stethoscopes around his neck. So when you see him walking around, say, "Are you Dr. Harper?" Dr. Harper has only been counseling with us since last November. And what's been amazing to him as a counselor and as a medical doctor, how many counselees have religious spirits because they were seeking religious experiences and they got them. In all the years that we've been helping people to come to freedom in Christ, we have found the most difficult people to work with are those who sought not Christ, but an emotional experience, and in that process were demonized with religious spirits. And the reason it's so difficult to help these people is that these particular type of demonic influences only push them deeper in experiences. They don't push them to evil. I hope I'm making sense, but I'm telling you, this is a very dangerous thing to do. I want to get these feelings. Now, I'm willing to die to these feelings. I'm willing to let them go at this time. I am not going to fight or try to get that which has left me. This next one is so important. It's so very important. And that is because up to now, and as you do a deeper study on this, you'll find that we are fighting God. We don't like what's happening. We don't like the darkness. It's like we're on a roller coaster. And the thing starts, and you decide that you don't want to go for the ride. But maybe jumping off is going to be dangerous. And you're kind of just going for a ride, and you sense that you're out of control here. Don't fight it. Surrender. If you are wrestling with God, I have never known anyone to win. Just surrender in that darkness. God, I don't know what you're doing. But God, I can trust you in the darkness because I've trust you in the light. I don't know what's happening here. I've cried out to you. Before you, I know my heart is right. You know, I've searched my heart in this. And I don't know if I keep searching within, I'm going to get really depressed in all this darkness. And so, God, I'm going to trust you in the darkness like I trusted you in the light. I'm going to believe what you said, whether I have any feelings about it or not. I know beyond the shadow of a doubt that God loves me. I don't always feel that, but I know it. I know that God has given to me eternal life, and I will never perish. I have never doubted, thank God, my salvation from the time I got saved at 20 through the Navigators. I've always believed that once that was done, I was a child of God, and Satan could never shake that. And so I feel my heart goes out to those. Well, I'm not sure. Did I pray enough? Did I say enough? And I loved what Bill said. If there was a special prayer that you had to pray to be saved, it'd be somewhere in Scripture. And it's not there. And if you cried out to God and you wanted God to save you, He will save you. If you don't surrender and you are holding tightly to something, you ever had your kids hold on to something they didn't want you to see? They didn't want, what's in your hand? Nothing. You know, yes, there is. No, there isn't. You know, and so you try to open their hand. You know, you can give your child some pain to figure out what they got in their hand. Is God putting some pain on your fingers because you're not willing to open your hand and say, God, take it, whatever it is. You can just have it. I just surrender to you. I surrender to your will. Teach me what you want me to learn through this. I'm willing to go through this, and I'm going with my hands wide open. I'm not going to clutch anything that you want to take from me. And then following the dark night, if you look in Scripture, is blessing. There is a mysterious woundedness that somehow goes with the great darkness. And it accompanies the great blessing that follows the great darkness. Remember Jacob? After wrestling in the dark, he was blessed by God. And what was the sign of the blessing? Woundedness. The rest of his life, it was a reminder. He went through the dark night, and God had blessed him. I want to go to Isaiah 45:3. I shared this a number of years ago here in Knoxville. And I went through, the first time I ever went through the dark night of the soul. I had been discouraged before, and I thought I had been through that. But when I went through that, I was with an executive of a large Christian mission at that time, and it was a personal thing. It was not an organizational thing. What we're going through now in Sioux City, where our counseling center, is an organizational darkness. This was a personal darkness. And I had just come back from Australia, and in Sydney, we went downtown to see the Square Tower. Have any of you been to Australia? You know what shape the Square Tower is in downtown Sydney? It's round. It's round like a record. Or a CD, I should say. You see how old I am, record? You talk kids about records, what are we talking about? A CD, round like a CD. And it's a Square Tower. And to go there, you get on like a train. More than a subway, it's more like a train that takes you down. I remember as we went down, we went in this tunnel, and it was a long, dark tunnel, and we just kept going and going and going, going into Sydney from wherever I was in Australia, going in there. And that's what was like. I was like I was on a train that was going, this is back a number of years ago, going through this dark tunnel that I couldn't understand. I didn't know why. I searched my heart. I cried out to God, and it only got darker. You know, I went through this. And I kept thinking, there's got to be something I've done wrong. And that's a real trap of Satan, getting me into myself. You know that in my flesh dwells what? Oh, you guys know me. In my flesh dwells no good thing, so I'm looking within for something good. Isn't that kind of the wrong place to look? In my flesh? You know what's good about me? Christ in me. That's what's good about me. Not me in me. Christ in me. And so as I was going through this, I don't know how I was directed to this passage, but I was directed to this passage, and God gave me such a blessing. And I want to give you this as the very last thing. If you're going through the dark night, or you come along someone going through the dark night, they need Isaiah 45, 2 and 3. I knew verse 2. I will go before thee and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of brass and cut in sunder the bars of iron. I knew that verse, that God will go before me, and there's no hindrance that God can't just remove. When I was teaching at one of these Bible colleges, one of the students we had was coming from Africa. It was an African young man. And as he was coming to America, they were saying, be careful. Don't put your suitcases down, because in America, they'll steal them. That's in Africa. I mean, in Africa, when you go through the thing, it's you don't want to put your suitcases down, they'll disappear. But not so bad in America right now. And so here this young man, he can speak English, never been to America before, and he flies into either Kennedy, there's two airports, one's in New York City and one's in New Jersey. You know, if you've ever been there, you know there's the two of them, and you have to take a shuttle from one to the other airport. So he flies in, goes through customs, has all these bags, and he comes to these doors. He has to go outside. And he cried out to God, you know, if he puts these bags down to open the door, you know what's going to happen? The Americans are going to steal them. And so he prayed that God would do something miraculous, and he walked to the door, and they flew open. And he prayed again, and the other doors flew open. And so he came, and he told us about it at the college, how God miraculously opened the doors for him. But let me tell you, where it says, I will break in the gates of iron and all of that stuff, let me tell you, my God can break that stuff down. I don't care what's being thrown in your path. When you're walking with God, he can bulldoze that stuff right out of the road, blow it out of the way. But then it was verse 3. And maybe I had to be in darkness for this verse ever to speak to my heart. And he said, I will give thee the treasures of darkness, the hidden riches of the secret place, that you may know that I, the Lord, which call thee by name, in the God of Israel. When you're in the darkness, Satan will say, God doesn't care. You know what you can say? Huh, he knows my name. I'm not a number. He knows my name. And he calls me by name. And I'm going to trust him as I go through this deep darkness. The first church I ever pastored was out in Nowhere, California. Now, the name was not Nowhere, but it could have been. I knew when I was there, I was somewhere, but somewhere when you were there was nowhere. We had 480 people, and it was like 60 miles one way, 40 miles another way. This was cowboy and loggers. Here I am, a city kid, grew up in Los Angeles, and I'm with cowboys and loggers. And I was out of my realm. I was no threat to anybody up there. And these guys, my wife said, you ever notice when these cowboys come to church, we had high noon or whatever they call it, you know, with these guys standing in the back of the church looking for a place to sit. Unbelievable. It was really quiet. These roughneck characters and all this stuff in that town. Out here we were out in nowhere. But when you drove one way, you could see where the stagecoach used to come to town. And you look in the hills, there was a gold mining town and some gold mines you could go into. But there were some sluice boxes built on the hill there where they were doing the gold thing, which came down. If you want gold, you can pan for it. You know, do this. But if you want diamonds, you have to go in the darkness. Don't waste your darkness. Because in the darkness, when you're in the dark night of the soul, God wants you to dig for diamonds. He wants you to give you the treasures that you can only get in darkness. And when you go through the darkness and you come through that, those treasures that God opened up to you that you would never have seen because you hadn't experienced what the writer had experienced when they were writing this, or the depths of the meaning of those verses. When you have a beloved friend that's going through darkness, you can come alongside and share the treasures that God gave you. I know that a number of you are going through darkness right now. A number of you are hurting on the inside. And I'd like us to bow in prayer. And if you're here right now and you're going through some real darkness in your life, Will you, by faith, open your hands and let go? Is it a deep hurt or financial problems? Do you have a wayward son or a wayward daughter that maybe you don't even know where they are right now? Will you release them, open them up, and give them to God? Do you have a partner that isn't all that they should be? You know, when a woman goes through the dark night of the soul, she usually becomes very fearful. When a man goes through the dark night of the soul, he has a real desire just to give up. And so do you have a life mate that is breaking your heart and it's not what they ought to be, but they have a blue suit and a white shirt and carry a Bible and have a nice tie on? Just let go of that. Cry out to God for that. Let it go to the will of God. Say, God, I don't want to stand in the road or what you're doing here. I'm going to trust you. I will trust you in the darkness. See, are you going through a private Gethsemane? Will you lay down your human will? Will you, as Jesus said, Father, not my will, but what? Thy will be done. Oh, God, I just give this to you. I reach out and I give it to you. Father, you deal with it. Cry out to God, first of all, as Abba, Father, then cry out to El Elyon, the sovereign one in control. David said, when I go to the valley of the shadow of death, I will not fear evil, because thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Two pieces of wood. How did two sticks bring comfort to a man in absolute darkness? One was a club for the wolves. The other was a staff to guide the sheep. And David was saying, you're my shepherd, even in the darkness. It was a symbol that he was under God's control. Beloved, God is in control even of the darkness. Gather the diamonds, learn what he's teaching you, and right now we join our hearts. Father, we may not be hurting at this point. We may not be in a dark session, but we cry out for our brothers and sisters who are here that may be going through some very dark times. Father, you know what's happening. If there is a loved one, if there is something that's out of their control, they can't control it, they don't know where this person is or what's going on, you know where they are. And Father, we pray that you would minister to their hearts and lives. Father, we're thankful for the ability of putting your word in the hearts of young people, and that you, if they are not walking with you, you can bring that word up and bring conviction and bring them back to yourself. You know the needs of those that are here in darkness. We release them to you. Meet those needs, Father. And as they go through, give them diamonds. Give them a very special truth or truths that they can hang on to as they go through this time. Because, Father, we know that all of us at some point in time have, are, or will go through the tunnel of darkness. But, Father, we thank you that it's never permanent and there's light at the end. And we just look to you to guard our hearts, to remove the dross. Draw us deeper. And then, Father, may we experience the blessedness that comes from the darkness, and that you would be glorified in our lives. We ask this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and for his glory. Amen.